racing now. Oh, which I win from last. A spectacular TJ win. Giga kick down the outside, wins the Everest. Shinzo and Ryan Moore have drawn clear to win the Golden Sliver.
With Tim Gilbert and Julie Snook, this is Racing Dreams.
Good morning and welcome. You are watching Racing Dreams on this spectacular Saturday morning. I'm flying solo today. Timmy will be back next week, but don't go anywhere. We have a huge show coming up for you this morning. Let's take a look. A legend is made. Les Bridge trains his second Doncaster winner 39 years after the first. We catch up with Arrowfield's John Massara at the Inglis Easter Sales. And when a rooster marries into racing royalty, Luke Rickerton joins us for 2 minutes with. Well, today marks day two of the championships at Royal Randwick, featuring four Group 1 races, almost $13 million in prize money. It is a good morning to Graham Hintem from Racing New South Wales. How good to see this sunshine.
Good morning, Julie. Sunshine is bright and out early here at Randwick as a hive of activity, and thanks for having us.
It is hard to believe it's been 10 years since the concept of the championships was born. Look how far we've come.
Oh, that's exactly right. It's cemented its place in the Australian racing calendar and really the global racing calendar. We've built it the grand finals of Australian racing, and there's an enormous card of action here today. We're covered by the world pool. It's going to be very exciting. So, no, it's been quite a success. And what we find out, bookends our year really well. You've got the championships in autumn. You've got the Everest Carnival in spring. And it keeps New South Wales front of mind year round.
I love what you said earlier in the week that, yes, it is the grand finals of racing, but it's also become the grand finals for everyone, as we saw with the country championships final last week. What a story, what a win that was, and to see so many owners there on the big stage celebrating in that moment was incredible.
No, it really was. The country championships final, you won't find a more excited group of owners after the race than that one. They really celebrate. I think they have a big function on the Friday night. They celebrate all through the night on Friday, and there would have been quite a few sore heads come Sunday morning, but that's what they're in it for. You know, it's part of the ride. This week we've got the Provincial Midway Championship, so for your provincial horses and those eligible for the Midway, it'll be a similar scenes, I suspect, after that one. And what it shows is racing's never been more accessible. So you can buy horses with country trainers or provincial trainers or Midway trainers and still get to compete on these biggest of days. And you don't have to own 100%. You might only have 1% of those horses, but you're still an owner. You're still celebrating as a winner. And for the fans who want to get amongst it as well, in terms of accessibility of racing, the Winx stand here at Randwick is the best public facilities of any racecourse on earth, in my opinion. So it's just such an easy way to get involved in the great sport.
Yeah, it is such a brilliant location. We're out there last week for our OB, and it's such a great grandstand. And speaking of Winx, what a week for Australian racing with the record-breaking sale of her first filly, which, of course, leads us to today's Queen Elizabeth. It is always a brilliant race, but it's been 5 years since we said farewell to the champion on Queen Elizabeth Day.
Look, it goes very quick, doesn't it? I still have vivid memories of it. And who could forget the bow with Waller and Bowman sort of in front of that packed grandstand in the crowd. And everybody here almost had a tear in their eye at that moment. But as happens in racing, we move on. You know, there's the next generation of stars coming through the ranks. You know, you've got a horse today, Orchestral's gunning for six straight in the Group 1 Oaks. There's plenty of a hive of activity in the next generation coming through and plenty to get excited about.
And if you're sitting at home thinking of heading to the track today, don't forget to wear your Winx Royal Blue in honour of the five-year anniversary. You touched on this earlier, Graham. All 10 races today will be covered by the World Pool and watched across the globe. This has just been so phenomenal. The coverage, you know, I was watching online last week, the coverage and the stories that people right across the world are now getting access to from our backyard. It's pretty special to see.
That's right. The World Pool's been a great initiative of the Hong Kong Jockey Club. And what it means is customers from right across the world, so Hong Kong, US, UK, Singapore, France, New Zealand, Australia, all betting into the one pool, which means there's liquidity. So if you're going to have a Quinella, a win bet, a Quinella bet, a trifecta, first four, there's so much money in that pool that you can get the maximum dividends, which really for today means that there'll be some punters that hopefully jag a few of the big ones and get to have a great time as part of it. So This meeting today is the first time an Australian race meeting with 10 races, a full card, has been covered by the World Pool, and we're quite honoured to have that privilege.
Well, you like to keep an eye on the tips. Who are you liking today?
Oh, look, I might have given a little one away there earlier. The Kiwi horse, very short price in the Oaks, but she looks like an absolute star. I can tell you there's a few of us that got a soft spot for the Godolphin Runner and the Queen Elizabeth Cascadian with the big white blaze. You can't help but build a bit of a fondness for those horses that have those unique markings, but also that have had such a long career and a successful career. So he comes up against some superstars today, but he's done it before, he's beaten them before, and, you know, I think there'll be quite a few here cheering him home.
All right, well, before we let you go, we know that once the Autumn Carnival wraps, we move on to the spring. Planning is well and truly underway. And, of course, the likes of the Equimillion event that we saw in its first running last year. What can we anticipate for Equimillion 2024?
Look, I'm glad you mentioned it. So spring, it does come around very quick, but before we get into our feature racing of the Everest Carnival, we actually have the Equimillion competition for the retired horses run over the long weekend. So we're looking to launch that in the next couple of weeks for 2024. Last year was a huge success, over 300 horses competing over 3 days, over $1 million of prize money given out exclusively to retired thoroughbred racehorses competing in dressage, show jumping, show horse and eventing. Never been done before, and we want to go even bigger again this year. And it's the showpiece of our equine welfare programs. We've sort of built it as the Everest of the equestrian world. And what it is, it's about providing a market for those retired thoroughbreds after they retire from racing. The vast majority of owners do the right thing. They find a home for their horses. It's been happening naturally for generations. But we've put Equimillion in place just to add that incentive, ensure that that demand remains there. And it's been an enormous success thus far, and we know it'll only get bigger after we launch again this year.
And what's exciting is we've had some fairly big names in the game retire in recent years too, so we might see them out and about at Equimillion 2024. Graham, thanks so much for joining me. I appreciate your time. All the best today for day two of the champs.
No worries. Thanks for having us, and best of luck to everyone at home. Cheers.
Well, there's a reason that he is a Hall of Fame trainer. Over the years, Les Bridge has won a Slipper, a Melbourne Cup, an Everest, and now a second Doncaster. But of all his good horses, and he's had some good ones, Les thinks Celestial Legend, the grey son of Dundeal, might be his best yet. For jockey Tyler Schiller, it meant some gruelling work to get his weight down to 49 kilos, which excluded his beloved KFC from the diet. Makes sense. Timmy caught up with Les and Tyler after Saturday's incredible Doncaster win.
So 19 running in the 2024 Star Doncaster, and we're ready to go. Another Will the favourite. They're set. And the big field are on their way. Heracles and Militarized fighting it out for the moment. Nugget bursting through, and here he is, Celestial Legend. Did someone say KFC? Tyler Schiller has just won the Doncaster. Celestial Legend, the three-year-old, coming right down the outside, giving Les Bridge a second Doncaster. The previous was some 39 years ago with Row of Waves.
I knew he'd got held up in the race, and in those big fields he was waiting for the run to come, and it was just a matter of whether he could get up and win or not. But from where he was, I doubted whether he could, so when he hit the front it was just unbelievable.
Because there was a point there where you thought, nah, this can't work.
Oh yeah, well, probably a furlong and a half out. I don't think Tyler probably thought he could win either. He was trying to get out, and you can only do it if a horse is going well. And I thought the run had come just a little bit too late. But he's a remarkable horse, and I think the last 50 metres was just really amazing.
Yeah, I think you can see the explosiveness of him from the 200 to the 100. He came from back between horses, had to barge out, and when he did see that clear air, he was the only horse that you can see visually improve lengths, and his last split was very sharp, and I felt like he was very strong through the line, so hopefully going up in trip will only help, and I think he's got a great future.
Tyler had an accident 7 years ago. Doctors said you'd probably never ride again, maybe not walk again. Do you ever think about that? Were you thinking about that on Saturday?
Not really. I still think about it a few times when I'm at home, but when I went over the line, I was just thinking how good and all the relief of getting the weight off and getting the gap and winning the race.
We've timed this beautifully, Les, because he's heading out to the paddock.
Yes, he goes tomorrow, and he'll have probably 6 or 8 weeks in the paddock. And then I've got to map out a program, which I haven't done at this time, but it'll probably be either the Cox Plate or that $10 million four-year-old race at Rose Hill.
Is that the Golden Eagle? And what about the King Charles?
Well, they're the things we've got to work out. There's so many great races on today. It's like a smorgasbord, and I don't want to get greedy.
I get greedy at smorgasbords, unfortunately. That's why I'm not a jockey. What about the comparison, Classic Legend to Celestial Legend? I know they've got different breeding. One's a colt, this big guy, and of course Classic Legend was a gelding.
Well, he was a red-hot sprinter, Classic Legend. I think he was the highest rated sprinter in the world at one stage. And I think the day that he won the Everest, I don't think there's a horse anywhere would have beat him. He had a little bit misfortune after that with injuries and one thing and another, and we never saw the best of him after that. But at that particular time, he was unbelievable. This horse is probably, realistically, 1600 to 2000 will probably be his forte. But if I trained him, kept him fresh, I'm sure the horse would sprint well, just because he's just got that sort of ability.
Someone's smiling from you above, do you reckon? You just keep getting these good ones.
Yeah, I can't understand it. It's I'm like everyone else. I have my ups and downs, and as soon as I have a bad trot, out of the blue comes a horse like this. So let's hope it continues.
What about the magic of the industry, Tyler? I know you're just enjoying the ride, but it is fantastic. The highs, the lows can be tough.
Yeah, definitely. I think 3 months ago I could barely ride a winner, and then all of a sudden my last 30 rides I rode 14 winners. There's so many ups and downs, it's like a roller coaster, but we've got to savour the good moments, and when we get horses like this, we just have to savour how good they are.
Now all the talk about KFC, Tyler. Now take this as an IOU, but there's the bucket. How much do you love KFC? You had to really waste, didn't you, last week?
Yeah, definitely. I do like KFC every now and then. It's not too far from home, and tasted very good on Sunday afternoon when I had a little zinger burger, and I'd like to get a sponsorship one day, but at the moment I'll just keep getting on the good rides and paying for it.
A KFC sponsorship, there you go. If you're listening, KFC, Tyler Schiller is your man. Good morning now to racing journalist with the Daily Telegraph, Shane O'Cass. I think we can all agree what an incredible performance that was by Les, Tyler, and that great colt last week.
Yeah, absolutely amazing. That bucket was empty, Julie. I wonder where Timmy put it. But look, isn't it great to see Les Bridge up where he belongs? He really is a living treasure in this sport. He's a Hall of Famer, just recently inducted. Look, he was training winners when before a lot of us were born. So it's just great to see. He's a Mad Souths man. He's not having a good year on the football field, but he's having one of his best years training, and that's saying something because he's been there a long time.
Well, Shane, it's certainly been a big week of news in the industry. A couple of surprising announcements, one more so than the other, that Starmare Imperatriz, first of all, has been retired.
Yeah, absolutely. She was a little bit off her game, wasn't she, in the TJ? Played up a little bit before the start and just didn't perform like, you know, the Imperatrix that we've seen as a 10-time Group 1 winner. So she went back to New Zealand, which was always the plan. They've sent the vets to have a look at her. And Karen Fentonellis from Tiako reported that although she looked terrific to the eye, she trotted up well. She's just showing a little bit of wear and tear in the front knees and the fetlocks. And obviously Tiako put the horse first and they announced that she'd be retired. They're asking for submissions, or they have, from Inglis's, Magic Minions and New Zealand Bloodstock as to who and how they would sell this mare. And they put it at auction, of course, and she will, and that is going to be some auction to watch. I know we had one this week, but you don't often see a horse of the year get put up for sale, and I'm assuming that Imperatriz will be the horse of the year, and she'll be changing hands to someone with a lot of money in the next few weeks.
Yeah, well, we'll get to that auction in a moment, but Cylinder is also off to stud.
Yeah, it's the perfect ending for Cylinder. He was a terrific horse all the way through. His father, Exceed and Excel, was retired or from the roster, pensioned off. What a great stand-in he was, one of the best ever. He won the Newmarket. This horse won the Newmarket as well, as did Bivouac, who's also on the roster there at Darley. So, look, he's related to Lonro as well through his female line. He's got everything he could possibly want. Two-year-old speed, three-year-old Group 1 quality. And, he could be a slipper stand-in in years to come for sure.
Well, we've touched on this already, but all eyes were certainly on the Inglis Riverside Complex Monday for the sale of the Winx filly. I don't think we've ever seen anything like that at an auction before. It just looked extraordinary. The crowd, the build-up to this auction alone. And then we had an American businessman, John Stewart, on the phone throughout, who really got that auction right up to that $9, $10 million mark.
Well, he certainly did. I mean, most of us thought, and even the experts who predict these things, the prices of yearlings, you know, to within, you know, a few $10,000 either way, they all thought that the filly would make $5 million because that was the previous record. And that's about as much as most people in Australia would pay, who can afford it, for an untried sort of yearling, basically. But the night before, John Stewart, a Lexington investor, announced that he'd go to $9 million, which really put some spice in it. And true to his word, he did. He pulled out at $9 million. And lo and behold, in comes Debbie Kapitason and buys the horse, which I suppose it helped that she won the Derby on Saturday and she might win the Queen Elizabeth today, but it's still a lot of money. She part-owned the horse, so she doesn't have to pay the entire $10 million, but she's still paying a lot. But I just think it's great, Julie, that the horse is going to stay in Australia, is going to stay with Chris Waller, it's going to stay with Debbie Kapitas, or wear the purple and white. You know, we can follow it all the way through now from, you know, when it's broken into when it races to when it goes to stud. So a really beautiful ending to a great story.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll be speaking with Debbie Kapitas later in the show today as well. And well done to John O'Darcy at Inglis for his composure throughout that auction as well. Literally, the eyes of the world were on that one. Moving on today, day two of the champs. Isn't it good to see the sun's out, four Group 1s and a provincial final?
Absolutely. I can't believe this is not the second or the first day of the carnival put back a week because it was terrible last week, as everybody knows. But we got through it. The track race beautifully, I might say, and it probably or surely will again today. Obviously, the Queen Elizabeth is the jewel in the crown of the championships. Winx won it three times a few years ago. But now that she's gone, Julie, it's sort of opened these races up now. They're not just one-horse races. They're actually very competitive. But Chris Waller's got the favourite, the red-hot favourite, too, Via Sistina. She's world-class. She had one look at Australian racing a couple of weeks ago on the Randvet, and she absolutely bolted in, ran enormous time to do it. But it was a different race, run under different sort of circumstances, slow, early, fast, late. Today will be completely opposite, Julie, because we've got Pride of Jenny in the race, who is going to make this a very, very fast run. Queen Elizabeth, probably one of the fastest on record. So Via Sistina is going to have to do it differently, but a lot of people think she's going to do it anyway.
Soft five out there at Randwick today as well. The forecast is looking glorious. Sunny skies and 24 degrees. What do you also make of the other Group 1s of the day? We've got the Australian Oaks.
Yeah, well, the Oaks, it's another race that most people see as a two-horse race, and I think it is again. We've got the champion New Zealand filly, Orchestral. She won the New Zealand Derby and won it very easily too. She's up against Zardoski for a second time. Zardoski won the Victorian Oaks. But look, when they met in the Vinery, I know a few people were a little bit cool on the way Orchestral won, but look, I thought she was holding Zardoski well enough at the line. She was 4 weeks between runs. She's going to be a lot fitter for that, and 2,400 is more over her pet distance, not to say Zardoski. You won't run the trip either. But look, it is set up for a great clash at the moment. Orchestral's odds on favourite. We'll see if Zardoski can turn the tables. But it's, Australia versus New Zealand there at Randwick today.
We've also got the Sydney Cup.
Yeah, the Sydney Cup's very interesting. The Queen, the late Queen, has a runner in this that she bred, of course, is the favourite, Circle of Fire. Will be ridden by Andrea Azzini, a very, very well-credentialed Italian jockey. He rode two horses at Flemington 10 years ago in the Melbourne Cup and the McKinnon. They weren't great rides, but since then he's gone on to ride about 30 Group 1 winners. He's in Hong Kong. He's a superstar jockey. He's on the short price favourite, winner of the Chairman's last week, but he's got plenty of competition from a horse called Ash Run, the stablemate. He ran fourth in the Melbourne Cup last year, Julie, so he's got 2 mile form under these conditions, and there's plenty of others as well. It's often a blowout, the Sydney Cup, so you know, you'll have to see if a favourite can win, because they don't often win Sydney Cups.
Well, speaking of winning, you're doing all right in our tipping comp too, so we're just going to have to see how you fare this week, and we'll have the results next week. Some of us are battling it out at the bottom of the ladder. Shane, always lovely to see you. Thank you so much for your time. We'll catch you next week.
Thanks, Julie.
Well, stay with us. Coming up, the Sydney Roosters legend who married into racing royalty. We catch up with Luke Rickardson. You are watching Racing Dreams.
Racing Dreams is brought to you by Racing New South Wales. Enjoy all the action this Sydney Autumn Carnival.
Welcome back. You're watching Racing Dreams on this glorious Saturday. I've got some company in the studio with me, which is nice. I've been feeling very lonely in here. Good morning to Racing New South Wales, Mark Brassel.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good morning, Julie. Great to be here and keep you company, eh?
Thank you. You can stick around. Well, of course, there is a lot on the line this season with our own Racing Dreams tipping comp. Some are going very well, Mark. Some of us have other strengths.
Well, when I look at that table, me right down the bottom on my own, I think of George Costanza in Seinfeld when he gets under the desk and hides there for a week, and I think that'll be me next week.
Well, let's go straight into the tips for this week. Nick, our angelic Nick, is doing very well. We will get his tip a little bit later, but let's start with you. Who have you gone with this week?
I've gone for Tavvy Time in the Provincial Championships, race 3, number 1.
And then Nosy Park.
He's a pretty exciting fella, this. If you see this replay, he just puts 4 or 5 lengths on these horses. I know they weren't great behind him, but just the manner in which he puts them away. He's drawn 16, Dylan Gibbons is aboard. I can't understand why he's getting out in price, but I think he's the one to beat. He's going to just have a bit of a smother, 3 deep. He hit the line over the top of them. Chris Lees, as we know, is a gun trainer. He set this horse all along for a $1 million race, and that's his grand final today. And I think he'd be very, very hard to beat.
Chris deservedly has a few runners in this race as well. Soft 5 out there today. Sunshine, 24 degrees. I tell you what, didn't that track fare well off the back of last week?
Oh, unbelievable. The track staff, what a job they did. Mm. I saw pictures of the 1,000 metres where it was, you know, an inch underwater. Mm. And come race day, the way the track played, horses were finishing on the fence, out wide, from behind, in the lead. Full credit to the ATC staff, Michael Wood and company. It was just a fantastic day.
Yeah, and well done to Racing New South Wales too. I know they wanted to push on with that meet, and rightly so. Let's take a look at my tip. Let's look at it. I don't know how I'm going to go today, but I should do well with this one. Race 8, number 8, Via Sestina. Of course, this is a Yulong out of Fastnet Rock, Run the Ranvet, which we are having a look at now. So has that Group 1 to her name now. Goes in as favourite for Chris Waller and J-Mac. I'm hoping that combination combines today. We'll also talk about J-Mac in just a moment because he's in the running for the Nathan Berry medal. But this, she goes into this race as the favourite. Normally I try to look for a little value when I'm trying to get my tick on the leaderboard. I have gone for the favourite for this week, so a bit cheeky.
Why not? I mean, the way it won, it's going to be hard to beat. And as you said, J-Mac on fire, he'll give it every chance, no doubt. So,
well, let's have a look at everyone else's tips for this week as well. As we head into the final week, Nick has a lead. 4 from 6 tips correct. And at this stage, the only person that can challenge him is Shane O'Cass, who sits on 3 points. So if we're looking at the rest of our tips, does Timmy not here today? He's gone with Too Darn Lizzie in race number 4 at Randwick today. Shane's gone with Midnight Opal in race 2 also at Randwick. Nick and Kirsten have both looked to Newcastle for their tips this week. Kirsten with Justice Served, race 3, number 2 in Newcastle, while Nick has gone with Empress of Wonder, race 6, number 2 at Newcastle as well. Mark, you're with Tavvy Time. Isabella, who is off getting married today.
Oh, yeah.
Bless Bella, Lady of Camelot. Also a very good pick, race 4, number 1 at Randwick. And Ray has gone with Randwick as well, race 1, number 3. So Ray is desperate for a win. We know that. Ray is desperate for a win. So let's take a very quick look at that leaderboard, if we could, guys, just to see who's sitting where. There we go. Nick, I'm glad he's our tipster.
Lot of red.
Lot of red. We didn't do well week 4. No one did well week 4. A lot of red. Not so great last week either, but there you go. Nick is the man to beat. Let's see if Shane can get the job done, and let's see if some of us can just finish strong. Now, before we let you go, we mentioned earlier the Nathan Berry medal. We've got it sitting here with us. This is a very special medal, particularly this year. It has been 10 years since the passing of Nathan Berry.
Yeah, absolutely. There's three in line, Damien Lane, Blake Shin and James McDonald. They've all got 4 points. Big clump of them just behind in on 3 points, but obviously James is the one to beat. J-Mac got plum rides today. But in saying that...
It's happened before.
Oh, well, 2 years ago, Nashra Willer rode Think It Over to win the Queen Elizabeth, and we'll all remember that outside fence-hugging run. Took it right to the outside fence to beat Zaki, and he got up and won the Nathan Berry medal. So anything can happen today, which invariably it does.
And, of course, just remind us quickly that the point system, it's run over the 2 weeks of the championships. Of course, it is in honour of the late Nathan Berry.
That's right, yeah. 3-2-1, the 5 championship races on day one and 7 championship races today. So over the 12, it's a 3-2-1. And today is where it all finishes, and it'll be another great day's racing. It's amazing how last week played out, wasn't it?
Oh, absolutely. This is very special to the jockeys. It means a lot to them. And it was lovely to see you this morning. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you very much.
Well, one of the greatest Roosters players of all time has a very close racing connection these days. Luke Ricketson, of course, is married to Kate Waterhouse, who happens to be the daughter of the First Lady of Racing, Gay Waterhouse, which makes Gay his mother-in-law. We spend a couple of minutes with Luke for Racing Dreams.
I think for me, just watching some of the big races and just watching, you know, horses go across the line, and you get such enjoyment out of watching the crowd, and you guys do it so well, right? You cover everything off, from the trainers to the owners to the crowd, and it's just a buzz every time you watch them. I think it's good with the Everest, doesn't it? I think it's like what a great concept, and love the attraction to that, love the crowd, love the way it's been promoted. I mean, we celebrate it so much here in Sydney, and yeah, the lead up to the Everest is fantastic, and we all get out there and have a lot of fun with it also. Probably when the mother-in-law won the Melbourne Cup with Fiorente, had a great time with that. We were down there as a family, watched that live, and celebrated pretty good after that with Ollie and a few other owners, and that was fun. Probably be Maccabi Diva. You know, 3 Melbourne Cups. I'll never forget watching her win her 3rd Melbourne Cup. I didn't know horses actually could do this, but I think she really got off on the fact of winning, and I remember... she paraded past the general admission at one stage with her chest poked out, and just came back past and knew she was a winner. And yeah, pretty spine tingling watching that. Not a trick question. We'll train her without a doubt. Gay and Adrian, of course, I can't say that. And obviously J-Mac, I mean, how could you not follow J-Mac? Love watching him step up on the big races, and you know, if you've got a really good horse and you've got someone like J-Mac on board, it's pretty much a sure thing. Got to be all the win, yeah. I sort of like going to the track, like cash and going straight on the win. Not too much on the Maldives. I just like going for the win. No, just straight on the nose, and I like pouring it all on that and just trying to maximise my cash that way.
Racing Dreams is brought to you by Arrowfield, producing Australia's best athletes.
Welcome back. You're watching Racing Dreams. Well, the Inglis Easter yearling sales provided the stage for one of the most extraordinary thoroughbred sales we've ever seen. The much anticipated daughter of Piero and champion mare Winx was sold for a world record price of a yearling for $10 million. It was Winx part owner Debbie Capitis and her family who were the successful bidders. Deb joins me now. Good morning to you, Debbie.
Good morning, Julie. How are you this morning?
Oh, Deb, I'm well. But more importantly, how are you and the family feeling? It's been a big week, I imagine.
Oh, absolutely huge. We're relieved. Little Winnie, you know, we've been on this journey with her, and to actually have secured her to race and then to have her as our our model, you know, she's just wonderful. It's very satisfying.
Take us back, because there has been such a big build-up to this sale on Monday. At what stage did you and the family sit down and think, you know what, we actually want to buy this filly if we can?
Oh, look, it's been a process. With the ownership group, we discussed what we were moving forward with this beautiful filly, and we totally were on board with putting her through a public auction and selling her on to someone else to have the wonderful joy of this journey. But about probably six to seven weeks ago, it just got to me. And at one of our weekly Wednesday meetings, I said to the girls and Paul, look, I really don't think I can part with Winnie. I feel we need her to be part of our journey. Very selfish. I know it's selfish, but it was like a granddaughter. How do you part with a granddaughter? So we then sat around and we chatted for a while. We thought about it deeply because as time went on, we knew it was going to cost quite a lot to secure her. Look, we're very pleased. What a great outcome for Winx to have sold her first filly for that amount of money. It's superb. But it just got more and more. And then once we got to Inglis, it was, yeah, seeing her every morning, just, you know, having her nip me, all those sort of things. It was a matter of, we're sorry, but we need to have her in our family still.
And how important, I know one of the bidders, the American businessman John Stewart, had said that he was very clear he wanted to buy this filly, but he was also very clear he wanted her to stay in Australia. Now that's guaranteed. It's guaranteed this filly will stay in Australia with your family. How important was that to you as well?
Look, all along we expected overseas interest in the filly, and, you know, you can't have an idol like that and not expect to have interest from Europe or Japan or America, as it turns out. But it does mean a lot to make sure she races here and then her progeny are born here. So it wasn't a major factor. We were comfortable, as I said, when we went through all of the facts of selling her, that if she went to Northern Farm in Japan or if she went to Europe or America, we were comfortable to go along and watch the ride with her and hopefully ensure that she was fine. But it just started to bite a little bit as time went on, and I thought, no, she's better here. Look, it would have been wonderful to have her race somewhere else and have her showcase the amazing Australian industry and the breeds we have here, the horses that we have. So no one could knock and say that, oh, they can only win here in Australia. But no, we stood our ground and decided that we just couldn't part with her. And so she'll race here, she'll stay here to breed. Look, if she turns out to be another Winx and everything, you don't know. She may go overseas and race. You don't say anything for sure in racing. It's a roller coaster ride, and you just have to go along for the ride. And that's what we're doing. So she's happily in the paddock now, back at Coolmore, just resting up because she had a torrid time. She was on show. She walked the catwalk hundreds of times. There were over 100 viewings of her. No model does the catwalk 100 times.
Can't say I've done a catwalk, Deb, so I can't really relate, but it was incredible to see the interest in her. It was also lovely to see, obviously, Chris Waller will be her trainer. I saw you FaceTiming Huey Bowman not long after the auction. Can you believe it's been 5 years since we said farewell to the incredible Winx at Royal Randwick on this day?
No, 5 years has gone very quickly, but 5 years does go quickly now. You still remember all of the times that we had with her. Look, 5 years is a blink in the ocean when you've been through it like this. So unbelievable. But today's the Queen Elizabeth at Randwick, one of the races that she made her own and her last final race. So it's exciting that racing is still as strong as it was 5 years ago. And I do believe she helped get the strength into the racing.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. No doubt about that. A huge day for you and the team with runners of your own today. We don't have time to go through them all, but I also just wanted to say how special it's been to see Wopat Bloodstock, you as a family, endeavour on this new chapter. It's just been so lovely to see the Winx story continue, and I think we all had a few tears with you there on Monday. It was a very special moment. So, Debbie, thank you so much for your time this morning. I really appreciate it.
No, thank you. And, I wish I didn't fall apart like that, but it was a very tense time.
All raw emotion. We love to see it. Deb, take care. All the best today too for the team.
Thank you so much. Bye now.
Well, what a Doncaster it was on day one of the championships for Stallion Dundeal. He sired both the winner, Celestial Legend, and the third-placed Militarized. Dundeal, of course, stands at Arrowfield Stud. And Timmy caught up with a very happy John Massara at the Inglis Easter Sale.
It's a exciting but very stressful day, I've got to tell you.
Remarkable price for that yearling. Obviously Winx, but it's a bit of what we've discussed over the years. It's this fairy tale wonder magic.
Yeah, she's a collector's item. She's out of the greatest of all time by a very good stallion in Piero. Who knows, you can dream. It's hard to put a value on horses like that.
Absolutely. Now let's talk about Dundeal, this stallion. What a talented stallion. We saw it with Celestial Legend winning, and of course you had first and third in that race.
Here he is, Celestial Legend, bombing them wide out. Celestial Legend won the Doncaster, nailing, I think, Pericles or Militarized.
Yeah, Militarized ran a great race. He carried 5 or 6 kilos more than Celestial Legend, so it was a terrific performance by him too. So those two sons of Dundeal really stood out on that day at the Doncaster, and I'm very proud of them.
Well, you've had a big draft, 60-odd horses here, and how have the Dundeals gone?
Well, the Dundeals have gone better than in the past, obviously. Everyone's chasing them, so we've been very fortunate for that, and we've had some lovely ones here. But overall, it's been a bit of an up and down sale, but there have been some very good prices, and there's been some lower prices. A little bit mixed, but overall, pretty good.
It's quite appropriate that we're standing here because Castelvecchio and Super Seth both were Dundeals or are Dundeals. And give us a little bit more through your eyes about Dundeal. I know he's a bit of a favourite of yours.
Well, he was a special racehorse. He won the Sydney Triple Crown as a three-year-old. An amazing turn of foot, a horse with an amazing turn of foot. And he's always been a favourite. And he began his stallion career brilliantly. These were two of his early starters, Castelvecchio and Super Seth. They both became Group 1 winners, and they're both at stud. So he's now seen as a stallion maker, Dundeal, and that makes his sons even more attractive in the marketplace. So Inglis has had a good time selling some Dundeals today.
Autumn Sun, going well, going along nicely. Our show goes back long enough to remember when you had to have a cup of tea to calm the nerves when he won the Rose Hill Guineas.
Yes, well, he's now a stallion as well, and he's establishing himself. He's still at the early times. He's oldest of three, and he's getting group winners now. He's got three or four daughters that have won stakes races. Still not fully established, but that'll come over the next year or two. No, he's doing very well as well, so I'm very pleased with him. He's exciting. He's at an early part of his stallion life, but looking very promising at this stage.
Now, finally, you mentioned the farm. Days like today, these last few days, don't happen with the enormous amount of work of your great staff.
Well, they're the A-team, A for Arrowfield, and A for being top of the grade. They're a great team we've got. We've got 125 staff and some part-time staff in addition to that. They're reliable, they're hardworking, they're honest, and they're brilliant at what they do, and I'm very proud of them, and without them, I couldn't do what I do.
Welcome welcome back. Thanks for your company on this Saturday. You are watching Racing Dreams, day two of the championships here in Sydney today. And, of course, that is where we find our tipster, Nick Burney. He is back for another week at Royal Randwick. And I tell you what, isn't it nice to see the sunshine and the clear skies above us?
Absolutely, Julie. What a week in racing can do. We're on a heavy eight last week and now we're on a soft five, but with this weather, it's going to be a good four. The rail goes out 4 metres today and I think they're probably just going to edge off the fence. That's usually what day two of the carnival does, but I've got four tips today. I think we can back a few winners, hopefully, especially with the roughy, which we'll get to last. But my first bet I want to go to will be in race three and it's number eight, Territory Express. And I've got a lot of time for this horse and it's a great initiative by Racing New South Wales on the provincial midway championship where all the trainers can come to town and race for the big money. So it's the horse in the pink there, just pushing out. It just doesn't have much luck. Now, I've got a bit of a love affair with this horse. I tipped it actually on the show a few weeks ago. It was 30-1 this day and just missed in that tight finish, but comes back to provincial grade. You're going to have to hold your breath because usually needs a little bit of luck, this horse. It can get back, but around the $4.20 mark, I think it's a really good bet. So happy to follow Territory Express today. The second tip I want to go to is in the feature, the $5 million Queen Elizabeth Stakes. Chris Waller trained, James McDonald rides. And this horse, if it wins today, I might just go on record and say it could be the top line weight for age runner in the whole entire country. So as we roll the vision of this horse's replay, this is his first run, her first run, I should say, as the import. And coming to the outside, they went at such a slow pace this day. So she wasn't run to suit, but just have a look at her get to the outside here. And James McDonald just half clicks her up. She just goes bang, puts them away, shows great acceleration. She's got that turn of foot, goes to the line full of energy, not extended. If she reproduces that, she's going to be awfully hard to beat today. And the thing is, there's a horse in this race called Pride of Jenny. So the race is going to be run at a fast pace, but you go back through her overseas profile and she can handle those tempos. So happy to be with her. I think she's easily one of the best bets of the day. Now going to a value play will be all the way in the last race. A horse called Say Magique for Graham Begg, who I'm going to put a line through last start. There was an incident in the race, but you go back through that form line and the horse that won that race was Chain of Lightning. It came out to win the TJ. Alenchi came out of that race. It's since won and also overriding won the Muswellbrook Cup. But this is two starts ago in the black colours, the red cap. Now, just doesn't have a lot of luck, but once gets out, really wants to savage the line. The big thing for me, though, today is the blinkers go on. That's the big tick. Barrier 9 for Tim Clark. He's been with her all the way through. I think you can get it back to follow, be on that three wide trail. And as I said before, they might want to come down the centre of the track. Blinkers on, her mind's going to be on the job, but she just might go bang around that $9. And of course, we all love a roughie. So we're going to go back, though, to the Sydney Cup. So over the 3,200 metres, the Group 1 Sydney Cup. I'm going to go over the Waterhouse and Bot Caliber, Major Bill. So last year, there was a runner called Explosive Jack. He won the Sydney Cup, and he did the Derby Sydney Cup double. So Major Bill's going to look to replicate that this year. And this is him second up. But in the form guide, he obviously is second up. He's going to be third up today, I should say. But he had a couple of runs and trials before this. They sent him over the jump. So don't be too scared that he's only third up. He's going to be rock hard fit. That's him out in front. He sprinted hard this day, but just gave out in condition. So optimal fitness now. He won a Derby, as I said, 51 kilos. Maps to get all favours. I think he'll give you a big side for your money, around that $23, straight to the front, and hopefully he just keeps going for us. So they're my four tips for the day here at Royal Randwick Day 2. And we're going to have a look at the graphic. So obviously the first one will be Race 3, number 8, Territory Express. And then I'm going to go to what I think is my best bet of the day, Race 8, number 8, Via Sistina. Race back in the last, Race 10, Say Magique. And then back in the Sydney Cup, Major Bill, as I said, at a bit of odds. And having a look at my multi, I finally got one of these NRL games home last week, which is the Raiders. I'm going to stick with them. They're in red-hot form. Via Sistina the win and Territory Express the play. So, Julie, hopefully for day two, we can find a couple of winners.
Thank you very much, Nick, and you're doing very well in our own tipping competition. So we'll see if you can get another green tick to your name this week, and then you'll take out the comp. Have a good day.
Thanks, Julie.
All right, well, let's have a look at the rest of our multis. We'll take a look at Timmy's now, and he's gone with Royal Randwick today, race 5. He has gone with Osmosis for the win. And then he's going with the Rugby League, the New Zealand Warriors and the Canberra Raiders to get the win. For me, my Multi today. There we go. I've gone for Lady of Camelot for the win, Via Sistina for a place. And the West Tigers, controversial, but last time I did go with the Tigers, they helped me out. So let's see if I can have some luck with my multi this week. Of course, as always, big thank you to our great sponsors, Racing New South Wales and Arrowfield. Another great show for you today. Day two of the championships here in Sydney. Thank you very much for your company. Timmy will be back next week as we wrap up the Autumn Carnival. We'll see you then.